Asian Network.
Bhuvan, you are a YouTube sensation. I mean, your career, your rise to fame is incredible. But just remind us of how it all began.
It began 3 years ago, and I was at home, and I used to play in a restaurant. I used to play music. And I was home, and I'd bought a Nexus 5 for myself. And I was watching the TV, and this news reporter was asking this lady, there were floods in Kashmir. And this news reporter was asking this lady that, how do you feel you lost your son in the floods? That was such a bizarre question, and that's how the media is nowadays. They find spice in everything. And so that lady looked at him and she started crying. And then I thought that I'll make a satire out of it. So I did a 15-second video, just a 15-second video, and I posted it on Facebook. Now, the people started watching it, and I have a family of four. I got 15 views. So I thought, who are the rest of the people who are watching this? And that excitement got on to me. Then I started posting more and more videos. And one of my video, it went viral in Pakistan.
How did that happen? And which video was that?
It was a confusion between a son and father.
Okay.
And I don't know if I'll be able to take the name of the title, because that title includes something.
Something you're very familiar for is a lot of swearing. No, it's strange because you became more famous in Pakistan than you did in India.
Yeah, and people in India thought that I'm from Pakistan. So whenever I went out on the streets, they used to address me as Janab, as Huzoor. And I'm like, dude, I'm here to buy milk. And do you think I'll travel from Karachi till here on a scooty? And that's how it all began.
And then when did you make that transition from Facebook to YouTube? Because of course, Facebook was one of the reasons you might have been more famous in Pakistan at the time is because YouTube was banned over there, right?
Exactly, exactly. So one of my friends told me that, dude, are you earning anything out of it? Like, no, like you should actually try YouTube. Then I discovered the magic. Then I started posting regularly on YouTube.
And from 15 views to now 12 million subscribers.
Yeah.
It's an incredible journey.
It is.
How does
it
that feel, having 12 million subscribers?
It's a good feeling, to be frank. But to be brutally honest, it's really stressful.
Why?
I don't know. Earlier I used to do it out of passion and I didn't care about what anyone thinks of me. But now it's like when you upload a video, you upload anything for that matter. There are 12 million people who are right there to judge you. And that's really scary. So it's either good, it's either bad. There's no thin line between.
Last year though, you must have felt a sense of validation when you became the first Indian YouTuber to cross 10 million subscribers. That's a massive landmark, a massive milestone for anybody. But did it feel like you had really achieved something at that point?
I don't know, like the first million milestone was really special.
Because you got the gold plaque.
Yes. After that, I realized that the more content I make, the more quality content I make, the numbers will add up. And eventually 10 million happened, and it happened at the time when things weren't good at home. So I couldn't like really celebrate that milestone, but I was happy that it happened.
You mentioned home life.
Yeah.
What do your family and friends make of your YouTube career?
They're still scared.
Really?
Yeah, they're like, it's not certain. It's not a certain business. So you need to have some backup so that you can rely on that.
Are they worried that you'll use them for inspiration? Because I've spoken to Lily Singh, Superwoman, multiple times before about how, you know, her family's always a bit cautious now about whether they will be her next big skit. Do your family feel the same way?
Nope. So I keep them away from everything. So most of the people don't even know how my mom dad look in real life.
Right.
Yeah, that's my privacy, my kind of privacy. And I don't show my personal life out there because I have 16 characters of my own. I can portray them any way I want.
You yourself have said that YouTube India does not pay like maybe it pays in other parts of the world. Why is that? What's the issue there?
If you look at the statistics, in the past 2 years, the amount of creators which have come on the platform has grown 10 times. So, and it's a massive population. To keep a trace of everything, it's because people have now started using fake views. They've started using clickbait thumbnails, and which actually harms us, and it makes our image bad in front of the audience. Yeah. So for that, YouTube has monitored some things, and maybe that's why the monetization rate is quite low in India.
Your biggest income comes from brand deals,
yeah,
brand endorsements,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Collaborations with brands in your videos. Is it a tough decision to rely on YouTube as a full-time career?
It is. It is. It is actually. Also, the kids who have started YouTube channels now in the past 1 year, they keep asking us, do you think we should do this? We should do that. So I tell them that don't think that you can make a career out of it right
now. You give them the honest truth.
Yes. Don't make. Because people think that it's a great life from outside.
Yeah.
But when you're inside, we know how uncertain it is. A video will work today. Your best work wouldn't click with the audience. And that's disheartening.
Apart from just income, do you think YouTubers in India get the respect that they should? Essentially, you are viewed by millions of people.
Yeah.
You know, a video you uploaded 4 or 5 days ago already has nearly 10 million views.
Yeah.
That's a lot of eyeballs on you. And yet Bollywood and cricket are the two things that are seen to be the most bankable areas or kind of specialisms in the country. Do you think YouTubers get the respect they deserve?
I think the game has turned around. Earlier, Bollywood was the biggest thing India had. But now YouTube has, I don't think it has, it's like taken over, but it's at par. Because we get so much attention and so much respect now from the people in Bollywood. And it's actually true, because they know this thing that their movie won't get that much eyeballs in a week that they could get on a YouTube video.
For example, you collaborated with Shahrukh Khan just
before his
last release, Zero. Do you think that his production company saw the value in that collaboration?
I think they did, but I personally don't think Shahrukh Khan needs me. That was an honor for me that he agreed to work with me, because that was the first episode of its kind.
Yeah.
I started it with Shahrukh Khan, and I'm so glad he agreed to do it with me. He doesn't need me. He doesn't need anyone.
There will be a business tactic to it. You know, there will be a business move from Red Chillies that makes this an interesting collaboration for them as well.
Maybe they think it's actually true that the interaction between YouTubers and the audience is much more transparent than that of Bollywood. If I tell my followers that you should go and watch this movie, 80-85% of them would consider doing that, just because they think that he must be right.
And do you always tell the truth?
I always tell the truth. I always tell what I like, what I don't like.
In fact, you have said on record that you've rejected several brand endorsements, brand deals, if you don't feel like you can truthfully say that you believe in that product or that company.
Yeah, it's always been like this. I really feel my channel is a content-driven channel. I don't want to make it a commercial sort of a place. It's all based on content, and if the brand fits in perfectly, if I can relate with the brand, then definitely I'll go ahead with it. And I'm lucky enough to be working with brands who are really transparent with me. They give me a creative liberty. Now it's the best part that brands in India, they don't really work like they used to be before. If they think that he's capable of doing it, they'll give you all the leverage.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. They'll give you a few pointers.
Compared to what was it like before when you first started out?
So before, there were no startups. So they were all old age people who used to handle the companies.
Yeah.
And they were like, you can't say this, you can't do that. Avoid saying this, avoid doing that. But now people know what needs to be said in order to sell the product.
Yeah.
And we don't really sell the product. In my videos, if you see my videos closely, it's all about how Bhuvan kind of likes that product and how he uses it in his daily life. It's not at all a forced conversation.
What do you do with all that power? Because like I said, before it was seen that Bollywood and cricket were the two biggest platforms or sectors in the country. But now with YouTubers having a following that rivals Bollywood or cricket, what do you do with that much power? Do you feel responsibility?
It is a massive responsibility on a creator right now. Because I'll be really frank, people actually look up to YouTubers now. They think, because they relate to the age group is quite common.
Yeah. A
25-year-old would relate to me because he thinks that he's of my age. Maybe he's not lying, maybe he's telling the truth. Maybe I should listen to him at least. So that's why, and it's our responsibility to give out a message in any or the other way. Like out of 10 videos, 2 of my videos have a social message in it.
Yeah.
I did a video called Unfair, in which Bhuvan the character is teaching his mom dad that you guys are responsible for all the racism in the country. You guys are responsible for all the color discrimination in the country because you go to a wedding, you judge the bride on the basis of her color. You eat her food in her wedding and you come and bitch about her. And then I had a newspaper's matrimonial section in my hand and I read out all the requirements. The male should be 5'7", his income should be this. The next week, the same newspaper had a column which said, we apologize for anything.
Wow.
And that's when I got a call from Obama Foundation. And wow. I got invited for the town hall.
Amazing.
And I get to meet him.
I mean, that is an incredible achievement because you're not preaching to people.
Exactly.
But you are giving them you're not even giving them a message. You're actually just telling the truth about what's happening in society.
I tell them what I feel. I don't go on and brag about social issues every now and then. It just keep piling inside me. And when it's done, I blabber it out.
You know, I have to ask you that you have been criticized for the language that you use in your videos. But you are unashamed in saying that this is for a certain audience and that audience are accustomed to this kind of language. What do you say to the critics who think that your content is too explicit for YouTube?
I'm not forcing anyone to watch it. If I put a filter on YouTube, then there's no point of YouTube.
Yeah.
YouTube is about you. How you want to say it, how you want to do it. If I wanted to do a clean content, I don't get the difference between this clean and vulgar. These things are not there. It's kind of a genre. I've grown up watching Russell Peters. What he does is not vulgarity. He shows the truth. I have never seen two friends talk to each other without using slangs. I tell people, come to Delhi. You'll see how people talk. I'm from Delhi. I've grown up watching people talk like that. And it's not that I'm telling people to abuse. I'm showing what actually happens in the society.
Yeah, of course.
It's just that I'm not putting a filter in my language. It's the reality. People do put filters, but filters are for TV, for Bollywood. YouTube is you. It stands for an individual who can say whatever he wants.
But it's not just YouTube that you have. Your social media platforms are hugely popular. You have around 5 million followers on both Facebook and on Instagram as well, and a further 2 million on Twitter. Do you have to build a brand around yourself now? Do you feel the pressure of being relevant, of being visible, of being active?
I don't try doing that. It happens. I go with the flow. I've never thought of being relevant all the time. Whenever I feel, I post. Whenever I feel that the content is worthy enough to be posted on the media, I do that.
You know what I love on Instagram is your wedding commentary. So you did wedding commentary for Virushka's wedding.
Yeah.
And most recently you did wedding commentary for Ranveer and Deepika's wedding.
Yeah.
And I just love that at their reception, you are completely just taking the mick out of their guests, you know, this girl who goes and poses for the paparazzi, which I thought was brilliant.
Yeah.
And your commentary is so good. But are you ever worried about any backlash you might get?
Nope. I have never believed in insult comedy. I never insult people. So whenever you look at the wedding videos, it's not an insult.
It's not an insult.
No,
it's very funny.
It's funny. And the people in the video, they know that I'm doing that.
So do Ranveer and Deepika know that you've done this?
So I am in good talking terms with Ranveer.
Right.
I texted him that I'm going to do this. Though he didn't reply. But he didn't say anything either.
I'm sure he's seen it by now.
Yeah.
He has. I think Anushka has seen the...
And what does she think of that one?
I think she laughed a lot.
Okay.
Yeah, someone from the circle told me.
Do you think Bollywood stars are taking themselves less seriously now?
They should. They should have.
A long time ago?
Yep. But now the current league of actors, they're so chilled out. And it's like... It's a good feeling that we're all in the same ballpark anywhere.
Do you think that? Do you think that now YouTubers and young Bollywood stars are part of the same group of people?
I think so. I don't know about them, but I think that we cater to the same audience.
It's really interesting that your inspirations for comedy growing up were not necessarily comedians in the West, but actually Bollywood icons like Govinda, Johnny Lever and Kader Khan. And we lost Kader Khan very recently. Yeah. I wanted to know if you have any memories or kind of particular films or scenes of the late Kader Khan that you want to share with us all.
I've actually grown up watching this trio of Johnny Lever, Govinda and Kader Khan. And right from Dule Raja, right from Hero Number One, right from Joru Ka Gulam. I've been a mad fan of Kader Khan's writing more than his acting. You watch a movie and you know that it's scripted, but their acting, it looks like they came on the set and they started doing it randomly. And that you can feel it off the screen that they're doing it, which is not in the script. That's why I respected all of them. And I really wished that I could meet him when he was there. But I've talked to my team and I really want to meet Johnny Lever, which is like my next biggest goal in life right now. I want to meet and I want to chat and I want to fanboy over him. And I want to tell him how much I love him.
Bhuvan, it's been a pleasure. Thank you so much.
Pleasure. Thanks for having me. Asian Network.